come with an open mind if you're a person who's hesitant to social media.
Hi, once again, everybody. Welcome back to the Comstock Channel. I'm Marlon Bowling with you. Always a pleasure to visit with you about all things ag-related. Well, today I have a treat for you. I have Zoe Kent on the line with me. And, well, I guess, Zoe, you would be classified as one of the new social media influencers, maybe, when it comes to agriculture. I don't know if that title really applies, but I think our audience would be fascinated to know what you're doing. You are a farm kid. Tell us where you're located.
So I am in Ohio, about an hour north of Columbus. I wouldn't say I'm an influencer. I don't know how much influence I have over people, but I'm definitely trying to at least share what we're doing on our farm. I just try to make family-friendly, slightly educational videos, get people a little bit hooked on what we're doing in agriculture, what it takes day to day to be doing what we're doing. And it's a nice little creative outlet for me.
Well, you know, the thing that I really enjoy about this, I don't know if you call it a profession that you're currently into here, but it really fills a big void there where people that aren't from the farm don't know what goes on the farm. And you really serve a great educational role. Because now, I mean, 98% of the people aren't from the farm anymore. And I think it's excellent the way you portray things and show the way things really are out there in the country. It's not a real easy life.
Well, thank you. And my mom actually says she's learned more from my channel than being married to my dad for the last 30 years, because she listens to me apparently a little bit more than him.
Okay, we just won't tell him that. So give me an idea. Okay, first of all, how would we find you on social media? What do you go by?
Yes, Farm with Zoe on every app. Zoe is just Zoe. I guess I'm technically Farm with Zoe Kent on YouTube. I couldn't get just my username, but I'm on TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. YouTube's the longer form content. Pretty much everything else is cross-posted. So if you have a preferred platform, I'm probably on it.
How often do you do updates?
Every day. Every day. There's always something going on at the farm. Stories show more day to day, you know, what we're doing. And then I try to show a mix of what we're doing, some funny jokes with my dad, some education, maybe some things that, you know, are relevant. I'm thinking a lot about marketing right now, so it might be some videos on my not good marketing plan. We'll see.
So, okay, if you do that every day, I get the impression this is actually more of a Zoe farm diary. Maybe you could look at it that way.
It's something like that. Yeah. You can definitely track exactly how the year is progressing, what we're doing in the fields. And I know all my neighbors can keep up with how much crop we have off and what the progress is just by kind of going to my page real quick.
This is interesting. So give us an idea of what you had to cover this year. From what I understand, in Ohio, the growing season was a bit of a challenge out there too.
It's always frustrating. We had a pretty wet spring. We did get the crops out fairly early, but just it was not, there were about 200 acres of beans that I knew I was not putting them in ideal conditions, but we needed to just get them out there. And then we had a pretty good growing season. And then in August, it decided to shut off pretty dry. Now, my county isn't in drought, but some of the surrounding counties are. But even with that, we had a pretty good corn yield and a pretty respectable bean yield given the weather.
Apparently you got a timely rain once or twice that kind of helped pull it through a little bit.
And then we had a really dry moisture, only ran a little bit of our corn through our dryer this year, which last year, nothing ever wanted to dry down. So just a really, really opposite from last season.
Well, I've heard such a wide array of conditions this year. You know, you go into Carolina, they were really dry early. Things were burning up. Out where you are, it was really dry. You go out to northwestern part of the Corn Belt, and there they had historic flooding. You go on the far west, out there in the High Plains, and there it was extreme drought again. And in the middle, then they had the best yields ever. So it really runs the gamut, and it really depends on where you live. Now, that really affects the markets too. Some people can really reap the reward of that. They get a high yield and a high price. I just wondered, in your case, where you are, how are the markets holding up this year?
They are what they are. Locally, our basis has gotten a little bit more favorable in the last couple of weeks. But I would say at the beginning of harvest, we were like 60 under, and now I think we're about 5 under where I'm hauling to. So it's improved in the last couple of weeks, just kind of getting away from those harvest lows.
So what do you do with the corn that you grow in your region there? Do you have a lot of ethanol production or feedlots, or what do you do with it?
Yes. So most of my corn goes to an ethanol plant, Poet Biorefining, and then I sell some to a feed producer. So both are getting directly used.
Looking back through the year and all the episodes that you were able to put online here, what seemed to be most memorable for you?
Most memorable. Well, I got to do a lot of things this year. It's been kind of a whirlwind. I had the opportunity to go down to Iowa to John Deere's, one of their test areas, and drive some fancy equipment. I'm not a large operation. I do not run the newest, latest, and greatest equipment. But because I've been doing stuff online, I've kind of snuck my way into testing out some of the cool stuff. So that was pretty cool. I got to watch an autonomous tractor drive itself back and forth through the field, getting some big fancy sprayers. That was pretty cool.
So in looking at some of your videos, it's obvious that you actually run this equipment yourself and you maintain the equipment. And that's unique in itself. I think a lot of people outside the farm would be amazed at that.
I have one full-time employee, JD, who is, people get confused because we run John Deere and his name's JD. So when I say JD's fixing this, sometimes they think I'm talking about someone else. But he's the expert. I would say he mentors me there, but it's been fun learning. I enjoy what I do.
So give me an idea. When you started this, you said around 2021, roughly?
I started on TikTok in June of 2021, and then I went to Instagram the next year, and then the Facebook the year after that. And then I started my YouTube this year. And then ironically, my Facebook's the largest, followed by Instagram, followed by TikTok. So
I have a feeling it's probably opened a few doors for you.
Yep, I've had some pretty cool opportunities. I've been able to turn it into a pretty decent side gig for myself. So really grateful for that.
Are you able to get any sponsorships or anything yet?
Yep, I work with Deere, Bex Hybrids, Fastline. I've been really lucky to work with companies that I have used their stuff for a long time. So getting to promote things that I've already been promoting has been really cool. I have a cat.
I'm right there with you. I fight that battle too here. So where would you like to see this go? I mean, you've already come a long ways in the last 3 years. How big do you see this getting?
Well, I'm not concerned about how big it is. I definitely want a quality people, you know, a community that I can really engage with. Sometimes when your videos get outside of your kind of your group, your normal people, that's when you get the activists, the people that don't agree with what you're doing and what your practices are. So I'm not looking to be the biggest channel, the get the most views, but just really continue to show people what we're doing on the farm and keep having fun with it.
I think it's interesting that, you know, a lot of folks your age, you know, I used to work at RFD TV, and a lot of the new people in the newsroom were like your age. And it was fascinating to see how they look at things, because they look at things from a different perspective because of the social media aspect and how things are presented that way. A lot of younger folks on the farm are looking at doing that and sharing their experiences that maybe, you know, maybe farming is not so old fashioned, you know, maybe it's not guys standing out there with a pitchfork in front of an old house anymore. It's a big business. You have to know a lot about everything, the way it seems. But have you been able to help other young people kind of get into this this venue, if you will, to help get the word out about what they do?
Yeah. I've talked with a whole bunch of people. It's kind of fun. I found that all the people that are in ag influencing, whatever you want to call it, are just like very transparent. I don't think anyone's an expert. Anyone really understands exactly how to, you know, promote themselves in the best way. So it's lots of jumping on phone calls with people like, hey, are you finding that this is working or that's working? And really just working as a team. And I found the same thing just with farming, talking about it online. People are really willing to share what's working on their farms and what's not working. I think sometimes when, you know, it's someone that's a state away or a couple towns away, you don't feel like you're competing with them. People are more open to sharing their what they found.
Have you had a lot of chances to talk with folks maybe in FFA or 4-H to work with them? I'm sure they have a lot of questions about how you do this.
Yeah, I spoke at the Ohio FFA convention last spring. I was the keynote speaker, and that was really cool just seeing young kids that are excited about ag and the new jobs that are coming online in agriculture. There's so many things coming down the pipe, and I think people are really excited, and I'm glad there's a lot of high school kids that are excited for it.
And that's something that's entirely different from what it was maybe 30, 40 years ago, where, you know, kids look at a career option, you know, moving forward. And it used to be they'd say, oh, I'll get into agriculture, I'll get into farming. And they were just kind of like, oh, you know, and there's not much excitement to it. Now, I mean, it's like in the space age. I mean, you're talking about robotics, you're talking about drone work and all kinds of bioengineering and that sort of thing. And now you're into the social media, and communications are instant nowadays. You're not totally separated from civilization anymore, like the way it used to be. This is a whole new opportunity. And I just wondered how much success you have in bringing new people into this industry, which is way broader than what it used to be.
Yeah. One of my favorite things I heard, someone come up to me and we were at a seed meeting and she said, well, my daughter told me, you know, if Zoe can farm, I can farm too. I'm like, that feels good.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, I'll let the cat out of the bag coming up here before too long. I mean, before you know it, we are going to be having our annual farm masterclass. And we're going to be talking about things related to all sorts of agricultural production and succession and that sort of thing, and business planning and that sort of thing. But you're going to be one of our panelists, I believe, at that masterclass. It's going to be held in Des Moines, Iowa, February 21st and 22nd. You can find all the information about it on the Comstock.com website. Just go to Masterclass and find all the details, how you can sign up for it and be a part of it. There's limited seating. It's very limited, and it's for good reason, because everybody gets some really individualized instruction there and some really high-quality speakers involved as well, including Zoe, for one thing. What do you plan on talking with people about there at that masterclass coming up in February?
Yes, for that, we'll be talking about social media and just tell you guys kind of what I've done to monetize it, make it into a business for myself, and share what I've learned along the way.
We will have you and, of course, several other speakers as well. I think we have several that are just devoted to this whole new plethora of information coming out, originating on the farm, which is awesome. It takes me back to, back in the late 1990s when I was actually the first one to broadcast online, exclusively online, with farm news and weather and markets and that sort of thing. And to see how this has grown, I'm just so excited to see that. So I look forward to seeing you at the upcoming masterclass. Anything that you would like people to come prepared for, like with questions or anything, if they're attending that masterclass?
Just come up with any questions you have for me for social media, and I'm pretty transparent about what I've learned along the way. So come with an open mind. If you're a person who's hesitant to social media, I definitely understand that some people do not see a value in it. And I do think social media can be a massive waste of time if you're not using it correctly. So if you're skeptical, that is fine with me.
And speaking from personal experience, it can be very intimidating. If you're
Yes.
thinking about getting into it, you don't have to be scared of it because it can be corralled. It can be contained. You can master it, and you're a perfect example of that. And it's nice to hear that you're not secretive about how you go about things, that you're willing to share that. So look forward to seeing you there. Thank you for doing that. Zoe Kent with us today, explaining about her operation in Ohio, and it's good to see you, Zoe. That'll do it for this particular episode. And for producer Brianne Hendrickson, I'm Marlon Bowling. We will catch you next time right here on the Comstock Channel.
Futures trading involves risk. The risk of loss in trading futures and/or options is substantial, and each investor and/or trader must consider whether this is a suitable investment. Past performance is not indicative of future results.